example, and Buddhism can be considered as totally Sinicized by the 7th, 8th centuries, meaning the Tang dynasty. And from that time onwards, you see, it sort of radiated over all Asia. And conversely, each time China itself was encroached upon, invaded or occupied by what the Chinese called barbarians, it was always assumed that those barbarians would end up being transformed and adopt Chinese civilization. And it was the case particularly with the Mongol dynasty that you have here in the 13th, 14th century, which was called Yuan in Chinese, and also again with the Manchu, which the Chinese called the Qing dynasty, between 1644 and 1911, probably the, one of the longest dynasties in Chinese history. And I'm always struck by the fact that 1644, you know, being born in France, you see, 1644 corresponds to the reign of Louis XIV, you see. And down to 1911, which is, you know, sort of just a century ago, early 20th century, when the Manchu dynasty, you know, was collapsed together with the whole imperial system, giving way to the first, the very first republic in the history of China with Sun Yat-sen, etc., in 1912. And the let's say the Mongol and the Manchu dynasties were both, you know, sort of progressively Sinicized, and until the collapse of the imperial system in 1911, China sort of remained in its centrality and used the tributary system, that is, the peripheral countries were supposed to show their allegiance to the center in the form of tributary offerings. And it was only in the middle of the, starting from the middle of the 19th century, that China started sending diplomatic missions to other countries. So so my point here is not to give you a crash course in Chinese history, but to give you the context of the, let's say, the introduction of Indian Buddhism. It makes it rather remarkable that, you know, Buddhism was introduced into China when exactly China was constituting itself as a sort of very powerful cultural identity. And so, of course, I mean, this, let's say, decisive introduction of a foreign form of culture and spirituality, you know, is to this day something of a mystery. And of course, I mean, Nalanda is quite, you know, symbolic of this mystery. And I think it's important to tackle the subject in the present day, when China's official discourse is being entirely geared towards the Chinese rise to power, or the so-called or supposed rise to power. And in a way, we can see here that China is endeavoring to recover its imperial centrality in the East Asian region. And I think it's precisely opportune to remind ourselves of the periods in the Chinese past when the Chinese themselves did not necessarily perceive themselves as the center of the world, and were even, you know, prepared to travel abroad, you see, on very sort of difficult trips, you see, to seek for some kind of truth elsewhere. And during the conference in January 2014, I've been talking mainly about one of the first Chinese pilgrims to India, and particularly to Nalanda, which is Fa Xian, who in his notes on the land of the Buddha, you know, the Fo Wo Ji, recounted, you know, his whole trip from China to India. And of course, he was a predecessor of the more famous Xuanzang, you know, who followed in his footsteps two centuries later, and who gave a very detailed account, especially of his stay in Nalanda. So the Fo Wo Ji is this narrative of a 15-year pilgrimage to India between 399 and 414, so between the 4th and the 5th centuries, with a view to bringing back to China some written versions of Vinaya texts, that is texts on Buddhist monks' discipline, in the Hinayana tradition. And we have a French translation of this account, which was done by the very first occupant of the very first chair devoted to Chinese studies in Europe, that is Jean-Pierre Abel-Rémusat, who occupied this first chair, you know, created in 1814, and we actually celebrated, you know, the bicentenary of this creation at the Collège de France last June. In the meantime, this account was translated again in a more modern, and more accurate translation in a collection that I edit in France, and the format would be something similar to the Murti or the Sanskrit clay library or the Murti, you know, classical Indian library with the Chinese original text, see, and the annotated French translation on the opposite page. I would start, if I still have some time, I would start, and if you are not already completely lost in my translation. Yes, all right. I'll you know, give you a sort of summary of what I was talking about in January 2014. So I started from a sentence that caught my attention in this Fa Xian's account, in which he talks about central India in terms of precisely the Middle Kingdom, Zhongguo. And I was really struck by this fact because by the 4th century AD, you know, when Fa Xian, you know, took this trip to India, Zhongguo, meaning the Central Kingdom, could only refer to China. Okay, so it's not by chance, you see, that he talks about Central India, you know, as, you know, the Middle Kingdom, and he, you know, sort of maintains this ambiguity, you know, because he talks repeatedly about Central India, you know, in terms of the Middle Kingdom, And this is corroborated by the fact that he talks about China, not in terms of the Middle Kingdom, but with various designations like the land of Qin, you know, this Qin dynasty, or the land of Han, you know, the Han Empire, or the land of Jin, Jin, which would be the name of the dynasty, the dynasty under which the Fashion lived. So this is quite striking because I take it to be very illustrative of a deliberate will from the part of this Chinese monk to decenter China, you know, for the first time, very deliberately. And so I won't go into the detail of this, but he also talks repeatedly about himself and his companions as coming from the borderland. You know, in Chinese it's a biandi, you know, it's a peripheral land. Instead of saying that we come, you know, we Chinese monks come from the Middle Kingdom, you know, he whenever he comes into contact with some Indian monks, he would present himself as coming from a borderland, okay, from a peripheral land. And this is really quite remarkable. And on top of this, he repeatedly describes what he calls the Middle Kingdom, that is Central India. It's actually North Central India, as a sort of ideal kingdom. You know, typically, you know, sort of idealizing, you know, Central India, saying that, you know, everything is marvelous. You see, I mean, you find, you know, an abundance of delicious fruit. You know, the seasons are always mild, etc. Which is, by the way, really true. I don't know. I have this extensive quotation of the description of the Middle Kingdom, which takes place precisely in Patna, you know, at that time called Pataliputra. You know. The cities and towns of this country, I'm quoting from Fajian, the cities and towns of this country are the greatest of all in the Middle Kingdom. The inhabitants are rich and prosperous, okay, we were talking about Patna, and vie with one another in the practice of benevolence and righteousness. Benevolence and righteousness being, you know, Confucian concepts, you see. So you know, Biharis, you see, are you know, described as models of Confucian virtues. Every year on the eighth day of the second month, they celebrate a procession of images. So you have a very, you know, sort of colorful description of this procession, into which I won't go, but it gives you, you know, a sense of the prosperity and wealth. You see the splendor, you know, of this. Of this region, and they also say, I mean, the description also says that all the poor and destitute in the country, orphans, widowers, and childless men, maimed people and cripples, and all who are diseased, go to houses where they are provided with every kind of help, and doctors examine the diseases. They get the food and medicines which their cases require and are made to feel at ease, and when they are better, they go away of themselves. All right, so you have a very interesting description of this central kingdom, which is, you know, centered in Patna at that time. And of course, since we are here in, you know, in this central kingdom, you know, I thought it would be interesting to have a detailed account. And the central kingdom is so idealized that Faxian's fellow pilgrims, some of them decide not to return to China, that is to the land of Han, and decide to remain actually in India. Here I think I would end my talk because I would like to give enough time for questions. I think you got a sense of what was this decentering experience, which was reinforced later on with the translation phase, you see, of some Indian Buddhist sutras, you see, into Chinese. And that was probably the only experience in translation that China ever experienced before the coming of the Europeans, starting from the 17th century. Because so far, China, of course, had a variety of, let's say, languages, you see, but they're again unified by the script system, you know, which would be the same whatever the language and the pronunciation, because you have more autonomy, you know, in this system of script from the pronunciation than, for example, you know, all the, let's say, phonetical languages. There again, you have to measure, you know, what effort it took, you see, to translate a language like Sanskrit, you see, into Chinese. Not only from the conceptual viewpoint, but also from the very linguistic viewpoint. And so I think that in conclusion, you see, what the point I was trying to make, you see, as being valid for today as well, is that China claims now to, let's say, to be at the center of the globalization process, you see, via a competition with America. I think it still has to give a sense of what, you know, the continuous circulation of ideas and values would be, you know. I mean, China is still very much, you know, self-centered, and I think, you know, it's not a very healthy attitude, and I would, you know, wish China to let's say, look back, you see, at this decentering experience to understand, you see, what it is to be given an opportunity, you know, to borrow something from abroad or from another entity, you know, and considering, you know, what Buddhism, you know, brought to China, you know, I would say very bluntly, you know, that without the introduction of Indian Buddhism, you know, Chinese culture would be nowhere, you know, today. So I would end up here, and thank you for your attention.